live radio broadcast of New Baptist Church located at 610 28th Street in Huntington. You can join us at 11 o'clock for our morning worship service, or our evening services on Wednesday start at 6 o'clock for Awana in the youth group, and for the Bible studies it starts at 6:30. And we'd love to have you for any of those times. Will you join us as Jim leads us in prayer?
Let us pray. Our Father and our God, we thank you first and foremost for your Son Jesus, who died for us, but thank you, Lord, that on that Sunday he arose, that we could have eternal life with you. Lord, I'd ask that you'd be with Pastor Robin today, Lord, as he brings your message. Please anoint him. May his words be your words. Lord, we'd ask that you'd be with the listeners. People are listening on the radio today. Just ask the Holy Spirit touch their hearts as Pastor Robin brings the message. Lord, help us to, what we hear today, help us to make a change in our lives that we can better serve you. Lord, we'd ask that you be with all the pastors throughout the world who proclaim your message today. Speak through them. And Lord, we just ask that you would just be with us and go with us and help us to be a light to tell others about you and your Son and the Holy Spirit, Lord. We ask the Holy Spirit would just overflow within us. Lord, we would ask that you would please forgive us of our sins. We acknowledge, confess that we do sin, and please help us to do better. So watch over us and guide us, and be with the musicians as they play today, and just watch over us and guide us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank you, Jim. And our special music this morning is Maryland. Thank you so much, Marilyn. Now our message this morning is Pastor Robin.
Well, good morning. And it is good to be with you on this Sunday morning. I know we are still having some technical difficulties, it appears, but we're working on those and we can only do what we can do. But we are glad you're here. Again, I'm Robin Crouch, one of the pastors here at New Baptist Church, and we are so glad that you have joined us today. Either by way of radio or maybe you'll be picking this up on our YouTube channel. But we are glad you're here. Let me invite you, as Sherry has already done, to come to our worship service at 11 o'clock as we worship in service, or you can catch that service online through our Facebook page. And that's at newbaptistchurch.com, and you can find everything you need there on the front page. It is good to be with you. You know, it's important from time to time for us to revisit basics. Now, at this time of the year, a lot of our eyes and thoughts and stuff, I say thoughts, at least our attention is given to the arena of football. We just had the college national championship this last week, and now we're coming up on the playoffs for the pros, and I was interested that each year Vince Lombardi, that legendary coach of the Green Bay Packers, would begin the first practice each year by holding up a football and saying, "Gentlemen, this is a football." It was for them and for him back to basics every year. And I want to share with you today some of the basics of the Christian faith, and over the next few weeks to share those with you, so that I hope that it will enhance your walk with Christ and give you an opportunity to grow in that relationship with Him. Today, again, I begin this series of messages that I have called Solid Ground in a Quicksand World. What I hope to do is to give you some solid ground, handles that you can hold on to, that you can work on in your spiritual life, and through that you will grow in your relationship with Christ, and to do that in a world that seems to be built on quicksand, where everything seems to be falling away or not stable or sucking you in, all of those kinds of things. And so for me, like the coach, I look at you and say, it's time to go back to the basics. Over these next couple of months, what I want to do each Sunday is to share with you some of the how-tos that you can use, and that you can also share these with others as you seek to grow in your relationship with Christ. I believe that these are crucial to our Christian growth, to our understanding of who we are in Christ, and I hope that you will not miss a Sunday being with us. Today I want to address this issue, how to be sure you're a Christian. It was Billy Graham who once said that this area is the greatest area of doubt for Christians. Am I a Christian or not? How can I be sure? Evangelism Explosion, developed by the late Dr. James Kennedy, used this question to open conversations. You may remember it. Many of you may have been trained in it. But the question was, if you were to die today, do you know you would go to heaven? The answer to that question would reveal a person's understanding of their relationship with Christ. I think this, for me at least, is one of the two most important spiritual lessons I've learned as a Christ follower. There's nothing more important than this issue, the security of the believer. Once we understand the truth, it will free us to serve God and others without a major focus on ourselves. In 1 John, John writes these words. Chapter 5, starting at verse 11, says, "And the witness is this, that God has given us eternal life, and this life is in His Son. He who has the Son has the life. He who does not have the Son of God does not have the life. These things I have written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, in order that you may know that you have eternal life." No. Not hope for, not worry about, not think about, no. Not be concerned over, but you can know. Can we really know? Well, John says we can. But we need to go back and get some basic kind of things and to look at it. You see, our salvation, our relationship with God, our right relationship with God, is rooted in the character of God. We are saved by grace through faith without any human merit. That's what Paul tells us. You see, God draws us, he convicts us, he saves us, and he keeps us. We only respond to the work he's doing in us. Being a Christian is dependent on God and not you. You see, God is the one who sent his son to die for us. He then drew us and convicted us and gave us the faith even to exercise. Paul tells us again that it was by grace through faith and not works that we are saved. So if we did nothing to merit or earn our relationship with God, then there's nothing we can do to lose it. It is not us, but God who makes that decision. Now, let me give you just the biblical witness on this. I think it's important. John chapter 3, "For God so loved the world," many of you know this verse, "that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life." Later, Jesus said these words, "All that the Father gives me shall come to me, and the one who comes to me I will certainly not cast out." Jesus continued, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give eternal life to them, and they shall never perish, and no one shall snatch them out of my hand. My Father has given them to me. He is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and the Father are one." Paul writes to the Ephesian church in chapter 1, starting in verse 13, says, And you also were included in Christ when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. Having believed, you were marked with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance unto the redemption of those who are God's possession to the praise of his glory. Paul writes in Romans 8, "For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus." And in Hebrews, the writer of Hebrews says it this way, that God has said, "Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you." Wow. Pray with me. Father, I thank you for this, for your word and for the assurance it gives us, for the opportunity we have to be sure of our relationship with you, to be sure that we can grow in you, that to be sure that we are yours. Oh God, now use your word in us. For those listening today, I pray that you would open their spiritual eyes and ears to see and to hear what you have for them specifically, and then open their hearts to understand it and give them courage in their wills to obey you and to experience all that you've said. I pray this in the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. Well, this morning I want to focus our attention on John chapter 10 and those great verses we read a moment ago. The picture is of a shepherd, and that picture is often used in Scripture. See, they raised sheep for wool, so sheep would be with a shepherd for years. Folds were constructed in fields, making an enclosure of rock walls with one entrance. Many different flocks were kept in a common fold at night. The shepherd would lie across the entrance and control all that came in or went out. The shepherd would call and only his sheep would follow. The shepherd would check the sheep and treated their injuries. The shepherd also fought off wild animals that threatened the flock. And it's against that kind of a background that Jesus writes, or he speaks. He teaches. He didn't write. He teaches. And in John chapter 10, look at the pictures he gives of himself. In verse 10, he says, I am the door. He's the one who guards the fold. Everything must pass through him. He is the entrance to God. There is no other. It's only through Jesus that we have access to the Father. He said, I am the door. Starting in verse 11, he says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd dies for his sheep. It's interesting that in the Old Testament, the sheep died for the shepherds as a sacrifice. But in this passage, the shepherd dies for his sheep. Verses 14 and 15 says, he knows his sheep by name, nature, and their needs. He brings other sheep into the flock, many folds, but one flock, one shepherd. It says he takes up his life again. His resurrection is the power of our security. Continuing in John chapter 10, starting in verse 22 and down through verse 42, he simply makes this declaration, I am the Son of God. In this passage, Jesus makes clear, a clear claim to being equal with God. It's not misunderstood by anyone there. It is in this claim that he assures the security of his sheep. You see, I hear so often that, well, that's not really what he meant. But I will tell you this, that the people who heard him speak understood it. They understood he made himself equal to God. And they sought to kill him for it. But our security. In John chapter 10, verse 27 to 30, we read earlier, it's a powerful passage for us. Believers have been given eternal life, and that life is in Jesus. Jesus assures our security in several ways. Let me share with you some of those ways. By definition, we have eternal life, and that can have no condition. It cannot be terminated, or it's not eternal. Now, does that make sense to you? If I have eternal life, it can't be terminated. If it can, then it's not eternal. This life is a gift. This eternal life is a gift, not something we earn or merit. If we were not saved, if we were not saved by our good works, but by grace, we cannot be lost by our bad works. We are saved by grace through faith. Look at his promise. Jesus has promised that his sheep would never perish. That promise cannot be broken. In fact, Hebrews tells us that God cannot lie. Our position is in his hand and in God's hand. Listen to the language used. By definition, eternal or everlasting cannot be terminated. Again, if it can, then it's not eternal. No one, he says, can snatch them out of my hand. For instance, I take my ring and put it in my hand. It says, I put it in my hand. And then that hand is in this hand. And if I'm the ring, I'm in Jesus' hand, wrapped by God's hand. That's a pretty secure place to be. We've become part of the body of Christ. We now have Christ's DNA within us. Even if a part could be severed, if it could, I don't believe it can, but if it could, it would still carry the DNA of Jesus. You see, if we are not secure, well, then my question is, when do we lose our salvation? If we're not secure, when do we lose it? Is it 1, 10, 100, 1,000 sins? When? Now, if we did nothing to gain our salvation, what then can we do to lose it? But let me ask you again, is it 1 sin, 10 sins, 100, 1,000? What is it? See, if we're not secure, then it makes us schizophrenic, wondering if are we in or out? And I'm always focused on myself that way. Am I in or am I out with God? Am I in or am I out? And I'm always focused on myself, and then I'm no good. There's nothing good in me anyway, but I'm no good to God and his kingdom if my focus is always on myself. Well, what about your security? The Scottish theologian Samuel Rutherford said, believe in God's love and power more than you believe in your own feelings or experiences. Your rock is Christ. It is not the rock that ebbs and flows, but the sea of your feelings. Your feelings can be fooled. And they ebb and flow, good and bad, happy and sad. They're all over the place, your feelings are. And if that's how you decide to live your life, then you're going to be pulled from pillar to post. But many of you live unsure in your place with God. The promise here, remember, is only for His sheep, the followers of Jesus. Now, this does not mean that you can holler, I love Jesus, run down an aisle, be pulled through a pool, and somehow you're good and you can live any way you want to. Too many people do that. Those who are closely following Jesus and living by faith never have to worry. They never have to wonder. They don't have to look over their shoulder wondering, is God out to get me? Why? Well, because I'm secure. Now, let me give you some cautions. First, can a person become a Christian and live any way they please? And the answer to that is no. You can't. You cannot live any way you want. If you could, it shows that you never understood the forgiveness or trust. You can't live any way you want. Because I've given myself to Christ and I don't understand forgiveness of how dirty, rotten, and sinful I was and am. No, you can't live any way you want. So, running down an aisle, hollering, I love Jesus, being pulled through a pool, does not give you fire insurance. You cannot live any way you want. Second, it's more than an intellectual understanding. It's more than the big-time tingles. Running down an aisle, being pulled through a pool are not enough. Getting the big-time tingles in church, it's not enough. It's not just a feeling. It's a change of life. It's a commitment of yourself to Christ. You see, security requires an honest giving yourself to Jesus. Being born again into His family, it is then that we are secure. When I'm born again into His family. One pastor expressed it this way. His name was W.B. Henson from a generation ago. Spoke of his own experience just before he died. He said, I remember a year ago when a doctor told me, you have an illness from which you will not recover. I walked out of there to where I live, 5 miles in Portland, Oregon. And I looked across that mountain, at that mountain that I love. I looked at the river in which I rejoice. I looked at the stately trees that are always God's own poetry to my soul. Then in the evening, I looked up into the great sky where God was lighting His lamps. And I said, I may not see you many more times, but mountain, I shall be alive when you are gone. And river, I shall be alive when you cease running toward the seas. And stars, I shall be alive when you have fallen from your sockets in the great downpouring of the material universe. You see, if you're not a Christian, if you're not sure that you are a Christian, excuse me, let me say that again. If you're not sure you're a Christian, then you can make sure today. This is where you drive an anchoring stake, an anchoring point. When doubts come, then you can come to this day. January 15th, 2023, and from that point you can know for sure. You see, that's my story. As a 19-year-old college student, on December 27, 1967, I drove an anchoring stake in the ground, and I confidently go back to that moment, knowing that at that place I committed my life to Jesus. Now, let me tell you, as an 8-year-old, and many of you from here in Huntington knew my mom and dad, Bob and Betty Crouch. I said, I tell people I was in church from the time I was conceived, and that was every Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, and Thursday night for choir practice. I was there. At 8 years old, I went forward. I was baptized, and I believe at that moment I was a Christian. I gave my heart to Jesus. But I will also tell you that from that moment up until I got to college, Well, when I got to college, my heart was pretty far from God. Now, I was in church every Sunday. I lived at home. That was the rules at my house. We were in church every Sunday, but my heart was far from God. It's a college professor who began to challenge my life and my walk with Christ. And on December 27th, 1967, I made a commitment to Christ. Now, when the devil comes at me, if he wants to go between my 8-year-old and 19-year-old years, but I can always go back to that stake I drove on December 27th, 1967, at Rock Eagle 4-H Camp in Eatonton, Georgia. I drove a stake. From this point forward, you never need to doubt again. Go back, if it's today, January 15th, 2023, I drove a stake saying, God, I give myself to you. And from this point forward, you don't need to worry. Drive a stake, a place where you can go back to. You never need to doubt again. Hear again the words that John wrote to those new believers in that first century. Again, he writes this, and the witness is this, that God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He who has a Son has the life. Who does not have the Son of God does not have the life. These things I have written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God in order that you may know, K-N-O-W, know that you have eternal life. Not hope for, not wonder about, not wish for, but you can know that you have eternal life. That's the first of our solid ground in a quicksand world. Come back next week. We'll get to number two. Pray with me. Father, again, I give you thanks. It is good to be in this place. I thank you for the word, your word, and the assurance it gives us. The assurance that we are yours. That as we have committed ourselves to you, that you commit yourself to us. That our salvation is in your hands and not ours. And oh God, because we are secure, we can now live a life that introduces others to you. We don't have to worry about ourselves. But, oh God, we can be used by you to make a difference where we live. Let that happen in each of us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.